Good morning and welcome to the fourth meeting of the Health, Social Care and Sport Committee in 2023. I've not received any apologies for today's meeting. The first item on our agenda is to decide whether to take item 5 in private. Is everyone agreed?
Agreed.
We're agreed. Thank you very much. And the next item on our agenda is our first oral evidence session on the Patient Safety Commissioner for Scotland Bill. And today we will take an evidence from Baroness Cumberledge, who led the Independent Medicines and Medical Devices Safety Review. So I welcome to the committee, joining us remotely, Lady Cumberledge, the Chair, and Simon Whale, the Review Member and Communications Lead for the Independent Medicines and Medical Devices Safety Review. And I'll move straight on to asking Baroness Cumberledge a question on that review. The review, one of the recommendations of the review was the need for a patient safety commissioner. Now, obviously, that's happening in the English NHS, and the Scottish Government are proposing in this bill that we have a patient safety commissioner for Scotland as well. What was it in that review that led you to conclude that a patient safety commissioner is a good way forward in addressing the public's any public issues with the patient safety?
Can I just start by thanking you very much for this opportunity? We do welcome it very much indeed. And to say that I'm accompanied by Simon Whale. Simon Whale, Sir Cyril Chancellor, and I were the panel that went round England looking at safety issues. And in fact, we came to Scotland, went to Northern Ireland, went to Wales. But our review was really, we were commissioned to look at England. And we were so concerned what we heard from patients and the suffering that had gone on. And they were heartbreak stories. And we thought something must be done. And so we thought a lot about it, and we thought that if we could have somebody, and we named it as the Patient Safety Commissioner, this person whose whole remit was to talk with patients, to listen to them, and then to actually act to try and ensure that services were much safer in the future. I don't know if Simon wants to come in. Simon?
I would echo what Baroness Cumberledge has said. What we found was that the healthcare system was disjointed, it was siloed, it was too often defensive, it too often didn't listen to patients who had suffered avoidable harm. And we saw the Patient Safety Commissioner as Baroness Cumberledge put it in the forward to the report, the golden thread that would link the system together and hold it to account. But they need to be independent of the system, they need to have the resources to do the job properly. But their remit, their focus needs to be on patient safety, detecting trends of concern and getting the system to act promptly where the Patient Safety Commissioner detects such trends.
Now obviously, my colleagues will come in later about the difference to what's happening in the English NHS with regards to the remit of the Patient Safety Commissioner there, as opposed to the proposals for the Scottish Patient Safety Commissioner. But in terms of other deliberations ahead of you deciding on the Patient Safety Commissioner, were there any other discussions about alternatives to that? Was there anything that was discounted or in the mix of what you might have thought might be a way forward that wasn't going down this route?
Well, of course, our review was very comprehensive in that we spent 2.5 years going around the country, listening to people, listening to professionals as well as users of the service. And we really felt that, as Simon has said, it was this very disjointed system. We needed somebody who would pull it all together to be the golden thread that would ensure that safety was on the top of everyone's agenda. And I just have to say, having appointed the Patient Safety Commissioner for England, Henrietta Hughes, she has made a remarkable progress already. And we have been hugely encouraged by the way that she has embraced this new role, because it is the first for us in England. And in fact, I'm not sure there are many across the world. I don't know, I haven't done the research. Mm. But certainly, she really has taken this extremely seriously. And of course, we had a very comprehensive system in order to appoint a patient safety commissioner, and it was competitive.
Thank you very much. Sorry, on you go.
Sorry, may I just add that we felt that the patient safety commissioner was the only way of ensuring that the system could be held to account. We didn't believe that an organisation or a person sitting within the existing system would be able to do the job in the way that an independent patient safety commissioner could. So that's why we came to that view that recommending the establishment of the patient safety commissioner.
Thank you. That's really helpful. And that's a really helpful starting point, because I think the independence of the commissioner seems to be the absolute paramount reason for it, of taking them out of the system and being, I suppose, the watchdog of the system on behalf of patients. So thank you. That's very helpful to know that process, and that's why you came to that conclusion. Can I hand over to my colleague Emma Harper?
Thank you, Convener. Good morning to you both. I'm interested in the remit of the Patient Safety Commissioner, and I suppose comparing it to England as well, because we do have lots of commissioners in Scotland. In my notes, we've got an Equality and Older Persons Commissioner, a Veterans Commissioner, a Children and Young People's Commissioner. So I'm interested in how this would either work with all the commissioners, and how would it be different?
Well, we also have commissioners on the Children's Commission and so on, but this is the first one we've had within the health system. And certainly we felt it really, really important, as Simon has said, that we had somebody who was independent and out with the system. We didn't want somebody who was just a creature of the Department of Health, for instance. We wanted the independence that the Patient Safety Commissioner would bring. And we felt that the role was really important, not only to hold the system to account, but we wanted to ensure that the role was a statutory authority role. So this wasn't just a good idea. This had to be in legislation. And of course, it is. We also felt that the Patient Safety Commissioner really would have to have a very broad remit. And I have to say, one of our concerns even now is the question of resources that are allocated to the Commissioner, because it's a big job. It's the first time. And our Henrietta Hughes, who is the Commissioner, is still having to recruit staff and to set up the systems that she wants, because clearly it is out with the usual, Department of Health or other systems that are around. This is somebody who is very independent, and that is critical.
Okay, thank Emma. You. Just another quick question. Regarding the remit, originally we were looking at mesh harm or issues of sodium valproate, and that potentially could be expanded. So I'm interested in your opinion about whether the Patient Safety Commissioner should go beyond medicines and medical devices and look at obviously wider issues. In our bill, it talks about forensic medical services, but also I have concerns around rural issues and rural safety when it comes to a population of people that are engaging with health service in then more in distance travelled and urban settings, for instance.
Well, married to a farmer, I couldn't but agree with you. Rural issues are really important. But we just felt that to begin with, because there is so much suffering, there is so much to do in the three areas that we examined, we wanted to start with those. And one was Primidos, a medication that's given to women with poor results for the baby. The other is sodium valproate, which we are still struggling with because doctors are still prescribing and pharmacists dispensing sodium valproate. So we know it's damaging. So we're still struggling with that. And the first one, of course, is mesh, which is such a huge issue and has caused such terrible, terrible tragedies to women and their families and babies.
Just to add, in our report, First Do No Harm, we recommended that the English Patient Safety Commission should focus on medicines and medical devices, including the three that we examined in our review, but not limited just to those three, but to all. So Henrietta Hughes' remit covers all medicines and all medical devices. It doesn't go further than that. The reason we originally said it doesn't go further than that was because we felt that scope was huge enough in its own right. We didn't, in our report, rule out the prospect of the Patient Safety Commissioner in England taking on a wider and wider remit. As she gets established and her resources come on stream, that is perfectly feasible. And to your point, there are plenty of other aspects of healthcare beyond the medicines and devices themselves that have safety concerns around them or safety implications. So in principle, the Patient Safety Commissioner in England and in Scotland should have the power and the opportunity to examine all those different aspects of healthcare, not just one or two aspects of healthcare.
Thank you.
Thank you. Tess White has a question on this.
Thank you. I had to add two questions, but the second one has just been answered, so thank you for that. Baroness, my understanding is the approach taken in Scotland would mean that the Commissioner would not consider individual cases, but would instead monitor systemic issues, as you've talked about the golden thread. The first Do No Harm report emphasised that a Patient Safety Commissioner should be a public leader with a statutory responsibility to champion the value of listening to patients. So are you satisfied that the approach taken in Scotland satisfies that recommendation? Thank you.
Yes, I do. And I have read the proposed bill that you're going to be putting before the Scottish Parliament. And I must say, I agree with all of it. I think it's extremely well got together, and it's much more detailed and prescriptive than what we have been doing. And I think what you have done is actually extremely helpful to us. So individual cases, it's quite difficult. If you get bogged down in individual cases, you get into inquiries and all the rest of it. So we saw the Patient Safety Commissioner as having a broader role. We wanted this person to actually look across the whole piece. And, of course, cases she will come across, and already cases have been referred to her, but they're used really to assess trends and to see what is happening across the piece, but it's not for her to investigate individual cases. We've got the Ombudsman and we've got various other organisations and individuals. So we really saw it in a different role from what we already have.
Thank you.
Thank you, Tess. And a question on the remit from Paul Sweeney. Paul.
Thank you, Baroness, for your comments so far on this. It was quite clear to me in reading the background on your report and the report itself about the gendered aspects of the complaints in particular, and the harmful side effects seem to be disproportionately affecting women. So how would you suggest that a specialised gendered consideration of complaints is not overlooked, given the otherwise vast remit that the Commissioner will no doubt be undertaking and the volume of complaints that will be received?
Well, I'm going to pass that on to Simon, actually, because, I do believe that the healthcare system has to deal with everybody. So it's quite difficult if you start to divide it up into different genders and so on. And I'm not sure that's a really good idea. I don't know, Simon.
Well, I think what we found, as you have seen in the report, is that women and children were the people that were affected by the medicines and devices that we looked at. Overwhelmingly, women and children. And what we found was that the healthcare system is seems to be particularly poor at listening to women and taking their concerns about their own health, their own well-being, and the outcomes of their procedures seriously. Many, many women that we met around the country, including in Scotland, told us time after time that their doctors and other healthcare professionals and other system participants just did not listen to them, sometimes didn't believe them, told them that the pain they were experiencing was in their head, you know, really quite worrying and disturbing responses from the system, and sometimes no response at all. So I think you're right to be concerned that women suffer particularly in that regard, but I think it's for the Patient Safety Commissioner, her or himself, once appointed in Scotland, to work out how best to engage with women and how to ensure that women who sadly have a track record of not being listened to and not being taken seriously are indeed taken seriously by the Commissioner, so that the Commissioner can advocate on their behalf and address their concerns with the system. So I don't think you need a separate mechanism. I think we would argue it's for the Commissioner themselves to make sure that those people who are isolated and often overlooked, be they women or indeed others, need to be heard.
I would just like to add that I do think it's a family concern, and that often we've had partners who have come and told us what they felt their women have been suffering. And that has also been very helpful. So we've taken evidence from men and women who are partners of those women.
I've got a few members want to come in on the back, I think, picking up. Can we very short questions, please, because we've got quite a lot of themes to get through in the hour. The hour that's going to go very fast, I feel. So, Emma and then Stephanie, quick question before I move on to the next theme.
Okay, thanks, Convener, for letting me back in. The Rural Commissioner in Australia listens to people and advocates so that their voices are heard. And in your report, it was pretty clear that some people have been campaigning for decades. So regarding your view on how firm advocacy and listening to people needs to be for the Patient Safety Commissioner, I'd just like to hear your thoughts on how firm this advocacy role needs to be.
Well, I'd just say we have the most brilliant researcher who still actually works with us. And she did a lot of work on Australia and other countries as well. And so that was really helpful for us to see what other people were doing. But we felt in the end the obligation, the responsibility was ours. In our case, it was for England. But Simon, do you want to comment?
I think the firmness is a very important point. The Patient Safety Commissioner needs to be robust. They need to be clear, and if necessary, they need to be instructing the system to act. Where there is a genuine concern about the safety of a medicine, device, or another aspect of healthcare, the Patient Safety Commissioner needs to have the clarity and the strength of voice to compel the system to act. And the legislation needs to provide for that.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Stephanie Callaghan.
Thank you very much, Convener. Just touching back on the gender aspect of it as well there, I know certainly my daughter was really ill when she was small, and one of the bits of advice I would give to other parents was to make sure they took a male with them, because you do tend to be listened to much more. And I was just wondering, is there scope for the Commissioner to kind of make that an overarching issue, the fact that women don't seem to be listened to, and make it something that they look for in kind of all the evidence that they're looking at across all the issues that they're covering? I'm wondering if that's something that they're able to do.
Well, we've made it very clear that the Commissioner could call people to account. And because the Commissioner was independent and because she had powers in legislation, then it was possible for our Commissioner that we appointed to call people to account where she felt they were failing, and failing particularly users of the service.
Thank you. I'm going to move on to questions from Sandesh Gohani on the English Patient Safety Commissioner. Sandesh.
Thank you. Good morning. Thank you for joining us. I was just asking, we had a private session here where we were asking questions to our bills team, and one of the questions that I would like to ask about the English model, and Baroness, you just said that there was powers in legislation. What are those powers if bodies don't respond to Henrietta as in the timely fashion that she would like?
Well, it is in our legislation, and I'm sorry, I should have brought the Act with me, and I haven't, because it's been through Parliament. But it's very clear that she has the power to call people to account. And I saw in your Act that you're proposing at the end, well, is it today, I think, 31st January? I thought that was really interesting that you had include powers, because I think that is essential. It's no good just having somebody who can talk, but they must have the legislation behind them that will actually enable them to act as they think fit. And of course, you're proposing that, which I think is excellent.
I think the English legislation doesn't go quite as far as your bill perhaps does. So the Patient Safety Commissioner in England has the power to make it publicly known if an organisation is failing to cooperate with her. She doesn't have the power to compel them to do something. She can, as it were, name and shame them, but the legislation stops short of saying she can absolutely compel them. They have a duty to cooperate with her, and that's built into the legislation.
Do you feel that having powers, such as maybe being able to fine or public organisations, would be something that would be useful?
Well, in your proposed bill that you're putting forward, you do have the power to require information. Now, I think that's a very good power to have, because information is absolutely essential. You will know in your profession as well, you know, as a doctor, you need the information. And you have actually put that into your Patient Safety Commissioner for Scotland bill. And I think that's extremely good. And of course, you do bring in the question of confidentiality of information, which is part and parcel of that. But I think that power and require information in a formal investigation, now that is very powerful. That's, I thought, a very good way forward. And I do like your advisory group. And of course, our Patient Safety Commissioner, Henrietta, is now forming her advisory group, because that was also in our legislation.
Thank you. And just finally, were there any lessons that you learned and have learned in what's going on that you would say to us we need to maybe add in to our bill, or anything that we could do to improve it and not have to learn the same lessons that you have?
Well, I think your bill is very comprehensive. I think it's really good. And it sort of had a sort of tick box system with it. And, you know, there's a duty to have a plan. That's a very good start. I think very often people feel that they don't have a plan that everybody can sign up to and see what the purpose is. And you've got all that in your bill. And I do congratulate you. It's a really good idea.
Okay, thank you. We move on to questions around clinical governance. And they have been led by Evelyn Tweed. Evelyn.
Thanks, Convener. Baroness, written evidence highlighted a cluttered scrutiny landscape in terms of patient safety. Do you see potential for a patient safety commissioner to add some clarity, and what would be required for it to do so?
So you're absolutely right that the landscape is cluttered. But whilst it's cluttered, it's also siloed, and that leads to increased risk around patient safety and the increased risk of avoidable harm. We felt that the Patient Safety Commissioner's role is to encourage, and if not encourage, require the system to act in a more coherent way. And I think it's a role that, because its focus purely is patient safety, it doesn't have anything else to distract it from that. The Patient Safety Commissioner can require the system, encourage the system to act in a more coherent way. We absolutely accepted when we were considering this role that the risk is that you just place yet another mechanism into an already crowded arena. I think because of its independence, it's the fact that, as Baroness Cumbridge has said, it's out with the system, the Patient Safety Commissioner can orchestrate and require people to act in a concerted, coordinated manner in a way that doesn't happen, certainly hasn't happened in England prior to the Patient Safety Commissioner's appointment.
Can I just add one thing? I think it's critical is that the Patient Safety Commissioner that you appoint has sufficient resources to do the job. And I think we didn't pay enough attention to that. And indeed, the person that we have appointed is very good at negotiating, and she is actually managing to get more resources and more staff, because at the moment she's only got 4 members of staff. And you picked up the 4 members of staff. But actually, I think this role needs a great deal more, because people do have to look at the data. They have to examine what's going on. They've got to look across the whole piece. And that is going to require some more people of great talent, of integrity, who are going to be doing that. And so I just say to you, just a word of caution, make sure there's enough resource.
Thank you. Evelyn?
And just for clarity then, you're not worried about any sort of potential overlap with other governance bodies in terms of the Patient Safety Commissioner's role?
I don't think we were not concerned about that. There are, as has already been discussed, there are other commissioners, the Children's and Young Persons Commissioner. There is an obvious possibility of overlap there. But I think it's for the commissioners themselves to cooperate, talk to each other, keep open lines of communication, share information between them to avoid that duplication. I think from our perspective, we felt that was perfectly possible. They do have clear and distinct remits. Yes, there are occasions where they could overlap, but that overlap could actually be quite powerful in the public interest.
Okay. Thank you, Evelyn. And Tess, you had a question on this.
Thank you, Convener. Baroness, in Scotland, we have the Scottish Patient Safety Programme, the NHS Incident Reporting and Investigation Centre, the Healthcare Improvement Scotland, professional regulatory bodies such as the GMC, the Patients' Rights Scotland Act 2011, a patient advice and support service provided by Citizens Advice Scotland, and a Scottish Public Services Ombudsman. So the question is, how do you envisage that a Patient Safety Commissioner will fit into a seemingly saturated landscape without duplicating the work of existing bodies? And is there any evidence of this occurring in England? Thank you.
Right. Well, I'm sure we can match the number of organisations that you have already mentioned, and perhaps we've got more. I don't know. But certainly, I think that it is terribly important that all these organisations know what each other are doing, for a start. And secondly, that they talk to each other, that there is a coherence about it all. And the way you describe it, certainly, it's a big task.
Thank you.
Thank you. And can I move on to, we've got some questions about your appointment process, and they are going to be led by David Torrance. David.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning. Baroness, what is your opinion on the different approaches being taken in England and Scotland with respect to appointment of a Patient Safety Commissioner? And which approach does the Baroness think would be better for achieving the ambition she has for a role?
Well, I think the appointment process is really, really important. And we advertised it very widely. And to be perfectly frank, we were quite disappointed about how few people of the calibre that we were seeking applied for the job. Fortunately, we did appoint Henrietta Hughes, and she has made a tremendous impact already. And of course, setting up a whole new organisation takes a lot of time and energy and effort and resource and everything else. So she's had to lay down the different, the architecture, the foundations, everything in order to get this position in a strong position. And she is doing that. And in fact, she's having on Thursday a very big meeting where she's involving voluntary organisations, of course, people working in the NHS and beyond, and so on. And that's really important because the thing that Henrietta has done has made people aware who she is, what her remit is, and how she's going to go about it.
Thank you for that. Baroness, would you agree there is a risk the Scottish Patient Safety Commissioner, who isn't sponsored by a relevant Scottish Government department, would be easily overlooked because of this?
Well, I think it's quite careful.
as we understand it, the Commissioner will be accountable to you in the Parliament.
Yes.
And actually, I think that underlines their independence from the healthcare system, and we include in the healthcare system, the government sets healthcare policy, so it's part of the system. I think what we want the commissioner in Scotland, just as we want in England, to be a clear, strong voice for patients, someone who doesn't have to look over their shoulder and worry about who they might upset within the system, someone who says it as they see it and is constantly thinking about the best interests of patients. And reporting into the Parliament means that they are accountable, that it's transparent. I think that's a good way forward. I don't think we have any concerns about that.
Thank you.
Thank you, David. I'll move on to questions around individual complaints and how you're managing that aspect of things. From Gillian Mackay. Gillian.
Thanks, Convener. How would the Baroness respond to those who argue that the Patient Safety Commissioner should have a role in dealing with individual cases and complaints?
Well, we've shied away from that because we've got other organisations that can deal with individual cases. But I think it's absolutely critical that she has an organisation that really examines the data, that what's coming forward, sees the whole system, sees the whole scene, because she needs to see the trends and what certainly is happening. I don't think the Patient Safety Commissioner should get involved in trying to sort out individual cases.
That's great, thank you. How can the expectations of the public be suitably managed in terms of the Public Safety Commissioner's role in promoting the voice of patients without taking on those individual cases and complaints?
I think that there's a communication job to do for the Patient Safety Commissioner, both here in England and in Scotland, when once appointed, which is to make it very clear what their role is and what their role isn't, so that the public does have some understanding. It's not that the Patient Safety Commissioner wouldn't receive concerns from individuals. The job of the Patient Safety Commissioner is to receive those concerns, analyse them, and consider whether they amount to a trend and or a systemic problem. If an individual case doesn't amount to a trend, but is still a legitimate concern on the part of the patient, then we would expect the commissioner, certainly here in England, and I would imagine in Scotland, to signpost that individual, that person, to appropriate alternative organisations so that they can look into the case. So it's not that the Patient Safety Commissioner should ignore individuals, quite the opposite. The Patient Safety Commissioner is there to listen to individuals, but he or she is there to try and understand, is this a big picture problem, or is it just one individual isolated case of of poor outcomes.
Got time for one more, convener? Thanks. In terms of, you said about the communication piece for the Public Safety Commissioner, what do you believe is the most effective way of being able to communicate some of those changes that have been made as a result of issues where there are trends and things need to be changed either within individual health boards or within the system as a whole? It's a point that may provide redress and some comfort to some of those who have raised concerns. How do you think that should most effectively be done?
Well, partly by the Patient Safety Commissioner themselves, so they should be communicating clearly and strongly using all the appropriate channels to make the public aware that they have detected a trend or a systemic problem, that they have recommended or compelled the system to change practice, to change whatever needs to be changed, and that that is resulting in harm being avoided. So the Patient Safety Commissioner has a role, but we would argue that the system itself has a role alongside the Commissioner to say, you know, the Commissioner has helped us understand that there is a problem here, and we have acted, and here's how we've acted. So it shouldn't be a confrontational relationship, it should be a cooperative relationship, because we would expect, and you would expect, the healthcare system to be dedicated to safety, just as the Patient Safety Commissioner is.
Thank you, Gillian. And a number of members want to ask questions on this issue. Evelyn Tweed?
I'm fine, mate.
You don't have a question. Paul Sweeney?
Thank you, Convener, and thank you, Convener, and thank you for the comments so far. I was curious by the information from the Scottish Public Service Ombudsman showing that complaints and inquiries they'd received, around 64% relate to clinical treatment and diagnosis, and of those cases, approximately 60% were upheld. Does the Baroness think that noting that the public, the Patient Safety Commissioner, isn't responsible for dealing those individual cases, that there is an argument for the PSC to focus heavily on specific areas of healthcare and patient safety, such as clinical treatment, because, for example, of the 278 compensation payments paid out by NHS Scotland in the last year, that was £60 million of expenditure. So surely if we can get to the root cause of why so many complaints are being made regarding clinical treatment and diagnosis, maybe be in a better position in the longer term, not just to improve the patient journey, but also to achieve great cost avoidance as well.
Yeah, so I think we would completely agree with that. The Patient Safety Commissioner has the opportunity to reduce the risk of harm, and in the process, reduce the likelihood of litigation, of litigation costs as well. So their role is about helping the system, helping the taxpayer ultimately, because it's the taxpayer that funds that redress, that compensation, as well as ensuring that people don't suffer avoidable harm. But the commissioner has to have the ability to understand the picture in front of them, to interpret it, and to draw conclusions on what needs to happen. And then the system needs to act. And if all of that happens, then the outcomes that you're suggesting will be delivered.
And certainly with Henrietta, I know she's had a lot of talk with NHS Resolution, who are involved in litigation, and they have been very helpful towards her. So I think the more that these different silos are breached, and she is there, she is working with a lot of the different organisations. Because of her background, she knows the NHS and healthcare very, very well indeed. And that actually was a great asset, and is a great asset for her and also for the role. And that was one of the reasons why we appointed her, actually.
Thank you. Now we have questions from Paul Kane on social care inclusion.
Thank you very much, Convener. a number of submissions to the consultation on the Scottish Bill felt that the Patient Safety Commissioner should also cover social care, and indeed social care is very topical, I think, given the challenges in that sector. And I think also coming out of COVID, there has been a renewed focus perhaps on safety in social care. So I wonder if the Baroness thinks that there is a case for including social care within the remit of the Patient Safety Commissioner?
Well, I think at this moment, the person who's appointed has a huge role. And certainly once your bill is passed, and I presume it'll become an act, that person who is appointed is going to have to set an awful lot of things in train. And I am thinking about ensuring they recruit the right people, that they've got the right premises, they've got their independence. It is a very complex role, really. And I think to take on social care at the moment, certainly for ours, I think she really would not want to do that. Though, of course, one has to appreciate how much it does build into, or in fact, the reverse with the healthcare. And so I think it's something for the future, but I wouldn't put it on the shoulders of somebody who is newly appointed.
Thank you. I'm very grateful, because I was keen to kind of understand the challenges that might exist in doing that. So it was useful that you kind of followed on there. Is there any sense that later down the line, and I appreciate this is a kind of known unknown, but there might be a distinct and separate commissioner around social care? I mean, is your sense that it would be better to try and separate out the two and have maybe cross-cutting issues, but not necessarily the same person doing it all?
I think you're right. And I just think of the time that I was very involved in the NHS, sort of much more on the ground than I am now. And I also chaired social services for England. And it was very, very important to ensure that we were all working together. But I do think at the very beginning, let's get a robust system working. Let's get a good person who will actually manage these difficult issues. And of course, there's always the opportunity to talk and to have meetings together and so on, to unpack some of the issues that clearly involve both social care and health service.
Very grateful, Convener.
Thank you, Paul. And now we want to talk about something which you've raised a little bit throughout the morning. It's about resourcing. What is, as you say, a very complex and role and I suppose service that a Patient Safety Commissioner is going to provide. So I'm going to hand over to my colleagues, Stephanie Callaghan, to lead questions on resourcing.
Thank you very much, Convener. And it was certainly good to hear, Simon, in your response to my colleague, you talking about reducing the risk of harm and also possibly reducing the litigation costs as well. However, the Scottish Public Services Ombudsman has showed some concern that the resources set out in the financial memorandum actually fall short of the ambition for the post. So I'm just wondering what your comments around that would be.
Well, I think Baroness Cumbridge has already suggested that you need to pay particular attention, as I think we want to in England, on ensuring that the Commissioner has the right resources to do the job. It is a brand new role. This person will be starting with a blank sheet of paper, or at least with the legislation, but nothing more than that. The financial memorandum, as we understand it, suggests that the Commissioner will have four members of staff and will have, I think, a total budget of £500,000, which would include the Commissioner's own cost, their own salary. That is fairly modest, our opinion, given the scale of the task that this commissioner will be taking on, not just the the task of getting things going, of setting themselves up and creating a momentum around their role, but just the day-to-day requirements of the role going forward are really going to stretch a staff of only four. And I think Baroness Cumbridge has mentioned the importance of data and data analysis. So amongst those four staff, if that's all it is, there needs to be a real capability to receive, interpret, analyse data, draw conclusions from it. And each step of that data processing is complicated and quite significant. Just collecting data. So how does the Patient Safety Commissioner's Office go about collecting data? Where do they get it from? How do they get it? How do they process it in a way that's compliant with data protection legislation? All of those sorts of things, let alone the interpretation of it, require quite a significant amount of resource. So our advice, respectfully, would be make sure that you are satisfied that they will have sufficient resource, and that if it is only a staff of four, that they're four very competent people who will work very, very hard, because there's going to be an awful lot for four people to do.
So can I ask as well then, how would that compare then with the resources that we're looking at in England? And do you have a view on the kind of size of team that you think would actually be required in reality in Scotland?
Well, the four, I'm not quite sure how this has sort of come into the picture, really, because this is the first trawl that the Patient Safety Commissioner in England has done. I mean, she has recruited four people. She will be recruiting a whole lot more. And it may be possible that some of the data collection and all that she would want to put out to other organisations who are experts in these fields and would be reliable sources of information. So I think that it's really difficult at this moment to say how many, what the budget would be and so on. But I do know that already the Patient Safety Commissioner in England has negotiated a bigger budget than she was first allocated. She has put it over very strongly of why she needs more resources. And so far, the department has actually agreed, and she is now able to do more than she was first set up to do. I mean, she knows the remit of the job, and the person you appoint for Scotland will know the remit of the job, and will, I'm sure, find that they need a great deal more support and resource in order to do the sort of job that they're expected to do.
Very interesting and helpful. Thank you.
Thank you very much. And a final question for Paul Sweeney.
Thank you, Convener. Thank you for those comments so far about the budget constraints and resource constraints. I think there has been comments made in the bill consultation about this would effectively leave the Patient Safety Commission with an inability to practice to dedicate resources to any kind of investigatory work in anything other than an exceptional basis. Is this a concern that you do share, given the current budget of around £644,000 per annum? And is there a danger this could end up becoming just a PR exercise rather than actually a substantive mechanism to deliver justice for patients or deliver good outcomes for patients? And is there an opportunity to perhaps build greater collaboration with adjacent organisations, perhaps working more collaboratively and deeper with Parliament, parliamentary committees, for example, to extend the resource and practice available? Is this potentially an opportunity that you see rather than it simply sitting as a separate silo within the bureaucracy?
That's a very helpful comment, because Henrietta and I, we meet at least on a sort of formal basis once every month. So we keep in touch with what's happening. But it's her show. It's not my show. I'm just there. She wants advice. But you are absolutely right that is the way forward, that actually it is really important that enough resource is given. And people always want more. And you, I'm sure, have experienced that in other areas. So there has to be a rein on it to ensure that it doesn't go out of control. But there must be enough resource to make the job doable and effective, and that people will respect what's going on. And Henrietta certainly has been negotiating that, and she has certainly, she's been on a lot of platforms, she's been going around England, I think she's been to Scotland. So there is a communication issue that is absolutely critical to the world.
Thank you. I want to thank Baroness Cumberledge and Simon Whale for the time this morning, and also thank you for the tremendous work that you've undertaken so far on your review, and pass on our best wishes to Henrietta and our post as we start our process and hopefully getting a patient safety commissioner in Scotland. So I want to thank you very much for your time this morning. It's been extremely helpful. Thank you. We're now going to suspend the meeting for the short break.
So, welcome back. Our third item today is consideration of an affirmative instrument, which is the Community Care, Personal Care and Nursing Care Scotland Amendment Regulations 2023. The purpose of this instrument is to increase the value of payments for free personal care and nursing care by 9.5%. This is an annual increase. The policy note states that emerging evidence in recent years shows that the cost of providing personal and nursing care has increased significantly, and the payment made to providers by local authorities for self-funding residents has not kept pace with this. The Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee considered this instrument at its meeting on the 24th of January 2023, and they made no recommendations in relation to this instrument. So we're now going to have an evidence session with the Minister for Mental Wellbeing and Social Care and supporting officials on the instrument. And once we've had all our questions answered, we'll proceed to a formal debate on the motion. So I welcome to the committee Kevin Stewart, the Minister for Mental Wellbeing and Social Care. And accompanying the Minister, we have Marianne Baker, the Unit Head of Adult Social Care Charging, and Claire Thomas, the Policy Manager of Adult Social Care Charging for the Scottish Government. Thank you for joining us today, and I invite the Minister to make a statement.
Thank you very much, Convener, and good morning to the committee. Convener, thank you for the opportunity to speak to the committee today regarding a proposed amendment to the Community Care, Personal Care and Nursing Care Scotland Regulations 2002. The draft regulations before the committee today make routine annual increases to the rates for free personal and nursing care. These payments help cover the costs of those services for self-funding adults in residential care. Historically, these payments have increased in line with inflation using the GDP deflator. However, emerging evidence, including from the Scottish Care Home Census, shows that the cost of providing care has increased. And to help redress this, in the last 2 years, we have made above GDP deflator increases of 7.5% and 10%, respectively, to the rates of payment, a significant increase on the inflation rate previously used. We again feel it is appropriate to make above GDP deflator increase to the rates this year, and the regulations before you propose a 9.5% uplift for 2023 to 2024, and this will mean the weekly payment rates for personal care for self-funders will rise from £212.85 a week to £233.10 per week. And the nursing component will rise from £95.80 to £104.90. And it is estimated that this will cost around £15 million in the next financial year. This will be fully funded by additional provision within the local government settlement, as outlined in the recent 23-24 Scottish budget. And the most recent official statistics show that over 10,000 self-funders receive free personal and nursing care payments. They should all benefit from these changes, Convener, and I'm happy to take any questions from the committee.
Thank you, Minister. Members, do anyone have any questions for the Minister? No? We have Paul?
I just wanted to ask the Minister if he'd given any consideration to, given this as an annual sort of manual exercise to uplift, whether there was a formula that could be actually introduced that would make it a more of an automatic stabiliser that would increase immediately?
Well, the same system has been used since the inception of free personal care in 2002. And we have made adjustments in the past 3 years, as I've indicated, taking cognizance of the pressures that are out there, and to ensure that we are asking people not to pay too much in terms of their care. There are some things which I think could be improved in all of this, Convener, and one of the things which I think could be improved upon is the UK government reintroducing the attendance allowance payments that were given to Scotland prior to the inception of free personal and nursing care here. And if we look at attendance allowance, if that came back into play, and as I said, there are around about £10,000 people who are receiving free personal and nursing care. If you take those 10,000 people and to an average of £80, which is not the highest rate for attendance allowance. If that monies were restored, that would be £41.6 million extra that we would have to play with.
Can I also ask the Minister if there's any analysis undertaken by government about the extent to which profit is extracted from the care system? Obviously, it's important to undertake expenditure to ensure that care is provided, but there may well be instances where there are profits being generated as a result. Is the government maintaining a sort of oversight of the profit that's being generated to make sure it isn't excessive?
Convener, as the committee are well aware, we're undertaking a huge amount of exercises in terms of our work for the formation of the National Care Service. Ethical procurement is at the heart of all of that. And of course, we will look at all aspects of the care system, including profit.
Thank you. I don't think there are any more questions. So we now move on to agenda item 4, which is the formal debate on the affirmative instrument, on which we've just taken evidence. Can I remind the committee that members should not put questions to the Minister during the formal debate, and officials may not speak in the debate. But Minister, before I invite you to move, is there anything further you wish to say in relation to motion S6M07494?
No, thank you, Convener.
Minister, can I ask you to formally move motion S6M07494 in your name?
Convener, I move motion S6M07494 in my name, which seeks that the Health and Sport Committee recommends that the Community Care, Personal Care and Nursing Care Scotland Amendment Regulations 2023 be approved.
Thank you, Minister. The question then is that The question is that motion S6M07494 be approved. Are we all agreed? We are all agreed.